Today, I will be describing on juvenile nasopharyngeal angiopharyma, JNA, or angiopharyma. How to define angiopharyma or juvenile nasopharyngeal angiopharyma? It is defined as benign, highly vascular, and locally aggressive tumor of nasopharynx, which occurs exclusively in prepubertal and adolescent males. It accounts for around 0.05% of all head and neck tumors. The term angiofibroma was coined by Friedberg in 1940. There are a few synonyms for this tumor. They are angiofibroma, juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. As we discussed, it usually occurs in prepubertal and adolescent males, so it is called juvenile and also called as nasopharyngeal fibroma. Age of onset for this tumor is the second decade, that is from 7 to 19 years. The mean age at diagnosis is 14 years. Adolescent male. It may regress in late teens but may persist into adulthood. There are tumors which persist in adulthood also, but they are less common. The tumor starts fibrosing when the person reaches more than 25 years of age. Now let's come to site of origin of this tumor. This is commonly asked question in the exam. The tumor arises from the posterior attachment of middle turnit near to the superior border of spinopalatine foramen. This is the spinopalatine foramen. This is the spinoid bone, this is the palatine bone. So this is the spinopalatine foramen black hole, you can see here. So this arises from the superior border of spinopalatine foramen. The tissue of origin is supposed to be non-chromaffin paraganglionic cells of the terminal branches of maxillary artery. The tumor is vascular tumor. So it is supposed that the tumor arises from the terminal branches of maxillary artery. There are different theories of origin of this tumor, although none of the theories are correct. Most accepted theory is hormonal theory. As this tumor occurs in adolescent males, it is supposed that testosterone plays a major role in causation of this tumor. Next is desmoplastic response of nasopharyngeal peristium or embryonic fibrocartilage between the base occiput and the base sphenoid. This is also important theory. Desmoplasia basically means fibrosis of the tissue. So tissue becomes more fibrous and there will be angiogenesis, which leads to vascularity of this tumor. The next theory is hamartomas under the influence of testosterone. They form angiofibroma. Next is NETs cells, which are undifferentiated cells of epithelial tissue, which are found in the nasopharynx, leading to formation of the angiofibroma. Next theory, the tumor is supposed to be found by vestiges of the atrophied stapedial artery. You can see here, this is the stapedial artery and these are the vestiges. If the vestiges remain there, then they might form the vascular tumor. So as the tumor is more vascular, different theories have been proposed for the vascularity of the tumor. In the previous slide, we had discussed about hamartoma and desmoplasia. What is hamartoma? Hamartoma is benign focal malformation that resembles a neoplasm in the tissue of its origin. It is not a malignant tumor, which grows at the same rate as the surrounding tissues. It is composed of tissues elements which are normally found at that site, which are growing in a disorganized manner. Desmoplasia means growth of fibrous tissue or connective tissue. Therefore, in the nasopharynx, when there is desmoplastic response, that forms more of the fibrous and connective tissues, and hamartomas might form in the nasopharynx, leading to a mass of tumor. Let's come to pathophysiology of this tumor. The tumor starts adjacent to the spinopalatine foramen, as already told, at the superior border. This is the area of spinopalatine foramen. And the large tumors, they are bilobed or dumbbell-shaped. So these are large tumors which are dumbbell-shaped. They pass through the spinopalatine foramen to the pterygopalatine fossa and more laterally. And they come to the nose also. One portion of the tumor filling the nasopharynx and other portion extending to the pterygopalatine fossa. That might extend more laterally to infratemporal fossa too. How does the tumor spread? This is very interesting. The tumor, as you know, it's a vascular tumor. Most of the times, the tumor does not erode the bone. It can go to different foramina in the skull base and can spread to skull also without causing much of the bone erosion. The tumor might grow anteriorly towards the nasal cavity and maxillary sinus. As we have told, the tumor arises from the spinopalatine foramen. So it can go to nose, nasal cavity, and towards the maxillary sinus. Superiorly, the tumor might grow towards the sphenoid sinus, to the cavernous sinus, pituitary fossa, optic chiasma, and middle canal fossa through the anterior scalpus. The tumor may spread laterally to pterygopalatine fossa, as we have seen in the previous CT scan, pterygomaxillary fissure, and towards the infratemporal fossa and cheek. There will be big swelling on the cheek, which can be seen. The tumor again can go to the middle canal fossa through greater ring of the sphenoid. Therefore, the tumor can go towards the middle canal fossa through anterior scalpus or through greater ring of the sphenoid. As the tumor grows more laterally and superiorly, the tumor goes to infraorbital fissures and towards the orbit, that leads to proptosis and optic nerve atrophy. And posteriorly, the tumor can go to nasopharynx. The name itself signifies this is called juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. In the past, it was supposed that the tumor arises in the nasopharynx. Let's come to clinical features. First, to the symptoms. What are the common symptoms? The most important symptom being nasal obstruction, which accounts in 80-90% of the individuals. Second is epistaxis. Around 45-60% of individuals present as epistaxis, which is mostly unilateral and that is recurrent. So patient will have painless, profuse and unprovoked bleeding from the nose. Especially a child of around 14-15 years will have severe bleeding from the unilateral nose. That signifies suspicion of angiofibroma. Headache occurs in 25% of individuals, might be due to blocked paranasal sinuses or intracranial spread of the tumor. Facial swelling accounts in 10-18% of individuals. This gives rise to frog face deformity, or the tumor might grow towards lateral aspect to the infratemporal fossa and there will be facial swelling. Other symptoms like unilateral rhinorrhea, anosmia or hyposmia, rhinolalia closa, deafness, otalgia, swelling of the palate as the tumor grows inferiorly, deformity of the cheek also can be seen. The signs are nasal or nasopharyngeal mass in around 80% of the individuals can be seen on endoscopy, orbital mass 15%, proptosis 10-15%. Cheek swelling and trismus are features in extensive disease when there is involvement of the infratemporal fossa. Frog face deformity, as already told, when the infratemporal fossa is involved. Serosotitis media due to stage 2 block, the child complains of earache and oral fullness. Involvement of the cranial nerves, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th and 6th is also common. The typical characteristic feature is teenage or young adult male with recurrent epistaxis, nasal mass and nasal obstruction. This is very important. A child of around 14-15 years presenting to you with history of severe bleeding from the nose, you have to suspect angiofibroma unless otherwise proven. You can see the mass here, this is the nasal mass. You can see the mass here and you can see mass here with bleeding. How to investigate a patient with suspicion of angiofibroma? In the past, plain x-ray of nose and penis were used to be done, but it shows edginess of the sinuses and occasional bone erosion, although there is less chance of bone erosion in angiofibroma. CT scan of nose and penis is the gold standard. Contrast enhanced CT scan is a very important investigation of choice, both axillary and coronal cords. It can show the extent and vascularity of tumor. Hallmann-Miller sign can be elicited in CT scan, which is anterior bowing of the posterior wall of the maxillary antrum. Although it is not exactly the characteristic feature in angiofibroma, any tumor which are extending towards the pterygopalatine fossa will lead to this sign, especially vascular tumors or expansile tumors. The bone erosion or widening of the sphenopalatine foramen also can be seen. More than bone erosion, there will be widening of the foramina. Magnetic resonance imaging is also commonly used to see the soft tissue extent in cases of intracranial spread. Angiography, basically digital subtraction angiography, is important to delineate the extent of tumor, tumor plus, and presence of feeding arteries. As you know, they are very important from a surgical point of view. The feeding arteries are to be controlled first. Tumor biopsy is usually contraindicated because this is a highly vascular tumor which bleeds on torch and taking biopsy. The vessels are thin-walled on histopathology. They lack elastic fibers, and with absence or incomplete smooth muscles, it is the cause of excessive bleeding because there are no muscles to contract. Other investigations like complete blood count, urine RE, ESR, bleeding and clotting time, ECG, X-ray chest, blood group and cross match are important from surgical point of view. There might be bleeding during surgery, and the child might require blood. Axial cut, showing the tumor in the nose and nasopharynx going posteriorly. This tumor is coming towards the nose anteriorly, and the tumor is extending from sphenopalatine foramen towards the pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa. This is leading to anterior bowing of the posterior of maxilla, so called Hallmann-Miller sign. The sphenopalatine foramen will be widened when the tumor is there. You can see widening of the sphenopalatine foramen here. This is the histopathology. You can see staggered shaped blood vessels. They are the staggered shaped blood vessels with endothelial cells but no smooth muscle. That is the cause for massive bleeding in angiofibroma. This is the axial CT scan again, showing the posterior of the maxillary sinus has been bowed anteriorly and the tumor is bilobed. The tumor is in the nose, nasal cavity, in the nasopharynx, and the tumor is extending through the sphenopalatine foramen towards the pterygopalatine fossa and even the infratemporal fossa. This is a large tumor. The tumor is going more posteriorly also with erosion of bone. Main feeder is the hypertrophic maxillary artery, which is seen here as the main feeder. This is the angiography. Digital subtract angiography is important to find out the feeder. How to assess the disease? There are many staging systems for angiofibroma, but for undergraduates, you have to simply understand that stage 1 tumor is limited to nasal cavity or nasopharynx with no bone erosion. Stage 2 tumor is invading the pterygopalatine fossa or paranasal sinuses. The tumor is going more posteriorly as well as laterally and anteriorly. Stage 3 tumor is invading the infratemporal fossa, more lateral extent, orbit more superior, or paracel region more superior. Stage 4 the tumor is invading cavernous sinus, optic chiasma, or pituitary fossa. That means the tumor is going to intracranial. Now coming to differential diagnosis, what are the common differential diagnosis of this tumor? Because a child of around 14-15 years presenting to you with history of massive bleeding from the nose. First, you should rule out other causes of nasal obstruction like intracranial polyp, common in young adolescents, teratoma, it's a congenital tumor, encephalocele, dermoids, inverted papilloma, less common, rhabdomyosarcoma might be, and squamous cell carcinoma, less common. You should think of conditions leading to nasal obstruction. Other causes of epistaxis, both systemic or local, have to be searched for. And other causes of proptosis or orbital swellings also have to be seen. When the child presents to you with this typical picture of epistaxis, swelling of face, and proptosis. Let's come to treatment of the tumor. There are certain treatment options. Surgery is the gold standard. The tumor is to be removed. Radiotherapy is reserved for unresectable tumor, intracranial extension, or in recurrent cases. Around 3000 to 3500 centigrade of radiotherapy is given in 15 to 18 fractions over 3 to 3.5 weeks. Proton stereotactic radiotherapy, which is also called as gamma knife surgery, chemotherapy for recurrent tumors with previous surgery and radiation can be done, and hormone therapy to reduce vascularity of the tumor before surgery also can be practiced. In the present time, surgery is the gold standard method of treatment for nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Other treatment modalities are not commonly being used. What are the different surgical approaches? They are intranasal endoscopic approach, so through the nose with the help of endoscope, which is very commonly practiced nowadays. Transpalatal approach by small tumors in the nasopharynx. Transmaxillary through the maxilla, extended Denker's approach, midfacial deglobing approach, or extended lateral rhinectomy can be performed. Infratemporal fossa approach for the tumors which are spreading to the infratemporal fossa. Anterior subcranial when the tumor extends to brain, and image guided surgery is the recent advance which can be performed with excellent precision when the tumor is near optic nerve or cavernous sinus or the major structures. As we have already told, the tumor is very much vascular. So, pre-op reduction of tumor vascularity has been practiced with the help of embolization of feeding arteries. You should identify the feeding arteries during angiography and you have to embolize the arteries around 24 to 17 hours pre-operative. It is very important because if you do around 4 to 5 days ago, then there will be formation of collaterals, and if you perform by very short time, the embolization might not work properly. Therefore, 24 to 22 hours is the gold standard. Many materials that can be used for embolization, but gel foam and polyvinyl alcohol foam are commonly used. Gel foam is usually absorbed by approximately 2 weeks, and perivaginal alcohol foam is more permanent. Estrogen therapy is synthetic estrogen, diethyl estilbestrol 2.5 mg, 3 times a day for 3 to 6 weeks leads to cellular contraction, increase in collagen and fibroblasts, and decreases the bleeding and reduces the size of the tumor, but it's not commonly used nowadays. Testosterone receptor blockers like flutamide can be used. As you know, the tumor is supposed to be testosterone-induced tumor. Radiotherapy in the form of proton stereotactic radiotherapy and cryotherapy are also being used, but the most commonly used is embolization again. How do you select the surgical approaches? Intranasal endoscopic approach is used for small tumors in nose, paranasal sinuses, nasopharynx, and pterygopalatine fossa, and even for large tumors nowadays. Transpalatal approach or Wilson's approach is commonly used for small tumors in the nasopharynx, which also has been superseded by intranasal endoscopic approach nowadays. Transpalatal and sublabial approach. As we discussed, transpalatal approach is commonly used for small tumors localized in the nasopharynx. Transpalatal and sublabial approach, also called as Sardana's approach, can be performed for large tumors of nose or PNS or in the nasopharynx. Transpalatal plus sublabial approach. The tumor can be exposed from the palate and through the floor of the maxillary sinus. In transmaxillary approach through the maxilla, there are different approaches. It is used for tumors extending to pterygopalatine fossa. The approaches are Dinker's approach, extended lateral anatomy approach, and midfacial degloving approach. This is Dinker's approach. You can see here, you can resect the tumor by extended caudal lobe surgery. You can go more laterally and you can resect a big tumor. This is the inferior terminal, this is middle terminal. So, tumor going up to middle terminal can be removed by Dinker's approach, that is extended caudal lobe surgery. So, this is the extended lateral anatomy approach, which can be performed for large tumors going to the paranasal sinuses or even up to the pterygopalatine fossa. It is the Moore's lateral anatomy approach. This is the lateral anatomy incision, Moore's incision, which can also be asked in the exam. The tumor is being resected here. This is midfacial degloving approach. This approach gives no scar externally, so this approach can be practiced for tumors extending to nasopharynx, paranasal sinuses, more laterally towards the pterygopalatine fossa. Infratemporal fossa approach with or without craniotomy can be performed by tumors which are going to infratemporal fossa through pterygopalatine fissure. Anterior subcranial approach, as you can see here, can be used for tumors which have limited intracranial extension, you can see, and the tumor going to brain and to nasopharynx can be removed with the anterior subcranial approach. Image guided surgery, as already told, is used for small and medium sized tumors. The advantage of image guided surgery is it can have more precision about the tumor, and important structures like optic nerve, cavernous sinus area can be tackled with image guided surgery. Thank you very much.